My name is Georg Geiger. I'm pleased to present Value Holdings to you and also to Investment Ideas, who created really value through industry consolidation. In the next 20 minutes, I want to give you a brief overview about Value Holdings. I want to explain our investment process and how it worked in the Value Holdings Deutschland Fund. I have two examples of our fund. The biggest position, it is Wingmetall, and the youngest position is Heidelberg Cement, and I want to conclude thereafter with a short summary. About Value Holdings. We are an independent asset manager, value style of course, and invest only in equity portfolios. Foundation of the company was 1992, and since 1999 we are listed on the OTC segment of the Munich Stock Exchange. I think there is a strong alignment of interests between our investors and the management team, because all the team members are shareholders and also invested in the funds. In May 2002, 10 years after we founded the Value Holdings AG and we saw that our system works in the German market, we started the Value Holdings Deutschland Fund, and 6 years later, the European Fund. Unfortunately, 6 months too early, as you know, it was in the middle of the financial crisis. Also in 2008, we took over a small stock market listed company, rebuilt it into a portfolio AG and renamed it into Value Holdings International AG. We are quite small with assets of just 120 million, but this gives us the freedom also to invest in smaller microcaps. Our investment process. In Europe, there are about 5,500 listed companies. We had a screening. The first step is quite simple. We eliminate the companies or the industries we like least. Banks and insurance, for example, our model does not work for self balance sheet and their P&Ls, and they are not that transparent. Also, utilities and telecoms we don't like that much because of their strict regulation, and biotech or pharmaceuticals, as financial analysts, we don't understand their business well enough. The second step, there's a pre-selection in terms of profitability, of course, balance sheet quality and valuation. Also we've already heard before, look for EBIT positive over the cycle. As the financial liabilities should be below equity, PE below 15, price book below 2, and enterprise value EBIT below 10. As most of the value investors, we search for good business, of course, and that's not that different from other value investors. We look for an economic mode, for market leadership and pricing power. After this exercise, we end up with a universe of about 250 stocks, mainly out of the so-called old economy. There are industrials, automotives, and their suppliers. There are also construction and building materials, consumer goods, electronics, technology, yes, but not high tech, and also chemicals. We discuss the business model with the management and also look for site visits. We want to understand how management thinks, how they think, and also how they implement their ideas in practice. And the most important step for us is the determination, the calculation of intrinsic value. We do not use, as we already heard today, DCF models, because I think in DCF you can calculate every price you want. We use a self-developed multiplier model. It is based on our own company database that goes back until 1987. And there are some recession in this long history, of course. And input is quite simple. You all know PE price book, cash flows, return on capital, dividend yields, and so on. And after that, normally, we end up with 20 to 30 stocks in our German fund and with 30 to 40 stocks in our European portfolios. We want to have a minimum of margin of safety of 30%. How it worked in the Value Holdings Deutschland Fund, you see here, average performance over the last 15, 16 years is at about 8.5%, whereas the DAX was at 5.5%. And the fund was much more stable if you ever look here on volatility and also maximal drawdown, which is considerably below DAX level. Our target when we invest is to get an average return per year of between 8 and 10%. And as you see, it worked well over the last years. So, most of the time I reserved for the two examples, of course. I think Metal is the first one. I think it could be quite new, this name, for you, because it's really very small, with a market cap of just about 100 million, and also sales are in the region of 100 million. But they are world market leader. World market leader in clamping rings. What are clamping rings? They are used to close open top drums, and these drums are used perhaps in the chemical industry, in pharmaceuticals, but also in food and beverage. They also produce covers, seals, and handles for these kind of drums. There's a second segment in the company. It's industrial handling. Here they produce parts for forklift trucks, also trailer coupling systems, as well as clutch and brake pedals. Clients here, forklift truck producers, I mentioned it, and also machinery in forestry and agriculture. But as you can see here, with just 16% of sales, it's quite small, so the game of Ringmetall is clamping rings. We calculated an intrinsic value of about €4.80 or €5, and that gives us an upside from more than 30%. The history of Ringmetall. They started as an investment company with holdings in the metal forming industry, but it was not that successful. And in 2011, a young man, Mr. Petri, joined the executive board, and he concentrated on the clamping ring business, what was also in that time at Berger, the subsidiary Berger, was the market leader in Germany with clamping rings, with a market share of 80%. And he started selling non-core units, concentrated on that clamping ring business, and started a consolidation of the market with the proceeds of selling the non-core holdings. In 2012, he acquired the Turkish market leader, Cemsan. In 2013, he founded Berger Italia and took over the market leader in Italy, SGT. And he also expanded the business of Berger in Europe, Berger Closures in the UK, Berger France, Holland Ring in the Netherlands, and Berger Iberica. The next step followed in 2015 with the acquisition of Self Industries, the market leader in the US. And this was really a big chunk at this time with sales of about $28 million. And in 2017, he started to grow the Chinese business. They already had been there, but in 2017, he took over Hongwen and integrated into the Berger facilities there in China. So he closed the production, the entire production of Hongwen, and put it into the Berger activities. So today, There's a world market leader with a 70% global market share. I think the industry consolidation is completed now, and the integration of the acquired companies leads to high profit increase potential. Clamping rings are cheap. The small ones for the food industry, for example, are at about 50 cents per ring. The bigger ones for the chemical industries are at 1 euro or at 1.10 euro. And you all are aware, in the chemical industry, security is the main issue. So there is pricing power. Imagine if a freight train with this chemical trunks derails, the damage could be millions. And therefore, the client BASF, for example, won't discuss a long time whether the right price is 103 or 107. And that helps in pricing, of course. There are further growth prospects by widening in the product range. They are strong in clamping rings, but they are not in seals and not in covers. And I think there are some M&A opportunities, and I hope they will find the right targets to expand also these product categories. Also at Ringmetall, there's a strong alignment between investors and management because the CFO, as the CEO, holds 20% and the COO 34%, so they are the biggest shareholders of the company. And this year, they changed the accounting standard to IFRS and also the stock market segment from OTC to the regulated market. And this makes the shares, of course, more attractive for institutional shareholders. That's our history with Ringmetall. We started buying some months after Mr. Petri joined the board. We took part in the capital increase of 2013, and we not only exercised our rights, but also bought together with Mr. Petri as the shares of the not exercised rights. In 2016, we had to sell because the position reached 10%, and you know, as a usage fund, you have to sell if it reaches the 10%. And in 2017 and 18, we sold as the fair value was nearly reached. Now this year it came down tremendously. Today it was at about 310, 320. And if you deduct from the fair value of 480, a margin of safety of about 30%, you end up with 330. So I think it could be a good opportunity for buying the shares again. Risks at the Ringmetall? Yes, but we think not that much. Of course, the downturn in chemical industry would reduce demand for drums and also for clamping rings. Open top drums could lose market share to IBCs, but the shares of these two different containers are quite stable during the last year. One must admit the Chinese activities are still loss-making, because they were so small, but now, after the takeover of Hongwen, we expect the turnaround in 2019. And Ringmetall has a Turkish subsidiary, and you know all the headlines about Turkey, political, economic, foreign exchange, and so on. But they sold the entire production site there in Turkey last year, transferred all the money to Germany, rented back. So I think the financial risk in Turkey should be quite small. That was Ringmetall. And next example is Heidelberg Cement, our youngest investment. We bought it only last week when they had a profit warning. In size, they're much bigger with sales of about 17 billion. Market cap today, 11 billion. Intrinsic value should be somewhere at around 90 euro, and that gives us a potential of more than 50%. Heidelberg Cement is global number 3 in cement, but in aggregates, they are number 1. About 50% of sales are in cement, more than 20% in aggregates, and 28% in ready-mix concrete and asphalt. I think Heidelberg is the best vertically integrated company in the industry and active on all 5 continents. Also interesting, 50% of their products go into infrastructure and only 25% each in a residential and commercial building. If we look back to the 2000 years, we remember that in 2004, 2007, the markets was really booming. Cement companies earned EBITDA margins between 25% and 30%. And as the business was that good, they did really stupid acquisitions, all of the big ones. Also Heidelberg bought Hansen PLC for 12 billion euro. The others, Cemex, Rinkert, 13 billion. Lafarge bought Avascom in Egypt for 30 billion. But the golden times ended in 2008 when the financial crisis started. And they, of course, were hard hit because of their high net debt, their high goodwills, a slump in sales and margins, and rising financial costs. So in 2009 to 2015, the first target of all the majors was to reduce the financial burdens and also to optimize their regional footprint to improve margins, of course. Holcim at that time was the only one of the majors who didn't take part at the takeover battles, and they could snap Cemex Australia for just 2 billion, really a bargain. And some years later, the second consolidation wave, you see here, Holcim and Lafarge merged in a 42 billion euro share deal. There were long discussions how wise this merger is. I don't want to comment, but I think it was really wise for Heidelberg to take over Italcementi and also from CR Arch to buy Ashgrove Cement in the US. They consolidated the markets there. The cement market today, so all these M&A deals, and there was much more in the world, they dramatically reduced the number of competitors. Today, there are 3 big global players left, Lafarge, Holcim, Heidelberg, and Cemex. Of course, there are some regional champions. In China, for example, Anhui-Konj is even bigger than Heidelberg. It is number 2 in cement, but it's not global. They are active only in China. And the 3 global players, they do an active portfolio composition, entering attractive markets, exiting the least attractive. But least attractive not always means slow growing. Also, could be also weak market position. And if they sell their business there, it is a good opportunity for competitors to increase their market position. And now they look for capturing the benefits of scale. They do global procurement management, have global IT infrastructures, cross-region shared services, and so on. Or they look for a premium pricing strategy. That could work if you have a strong R&D with value creating innovations and good offerings to your end user segments. Why invested in Heidelberg? I think urbanization creates good opportunities for them, and the footprint of Heidelberg Cement is focused on these urban centers. They are, as I already told, the best vertically integrated company in industry, and that brings saving in procurement and operations, of course. They do active portfolio optimization. They already sold their activities in Georgia and in Saudi Arabia, for example, and they have a further disposal roadmap of about 1.5 billion euro. Their cash flow generation is really strong, with about 70% of conversion rate. And if you look here, during the last 10 years, I think it was a good investment for bondholders and also for the banks, of course, because of the high financial expenses. Net debt, after the takeover of Hansen, was at 17 billion euro. They brought it down now to 8 billion. They issued bonds with coupons between 6% and 9.5%. These bonds become due in 2018 until 2020, and now they refinance it with coupons of 1.6%. In the last 5 years, the dividend quadrupled. Total dividend was at 377 million euro last year. It was the first year that this was higher than interest expenses. And we think they will see continuously sales growth with rising EBITDA margins, further decrease of net debt, and rising payout ratios. So I think it's good for an investment in equity today. This is Heidelberg. Yes, of course. M&A led to high goodwills of 11 billion in their balance sheet. The prices for CO2 certificates are rising from 2 to more than 20 euro, but Heidelberg has sufficient allowances until 2023. And there's cost inflation in energy, and that was the reason for the profit warning of last week. Of course, a rise in interest rates is negative for construction spending, and in the US we have rising interest rates for 2 years. 35% of their EBITDA is from North America. The industry did not deliver returns above cost of capital for 10 years. That could repeat, of course, in a recessionary scenario. But Heidelberg delivered returns of above cost of capital since 2015. Influence of foreign exchange, of course. Their business in the US is strong, with 25% of sales in US dollar. Also in the UK, Brexit, 7% are in Great Britain. And the Indonesian rupiah is also strong, with 6% of sales. And trade wars, of course, if the economic sentiment will slow down, it's a problem for investment spending. So as you see here, we had a look on Heidelberg for years, but it was always too expensive. And now they came down from 95 to today 56 euro. And I think that's a good price to invest in this company. Yeah, summary. We are long-term investors looking for 8 to 10% per annum. If you look to the styles, I think we are closer at the Graham style, but not only looking for a price book, than to the Buffett style, who also accepts higher purchase prices for excellent businesses. No benchmark, and we see volatility as an opportunity. I think that's interesting, volatility like we see it today or last week. I'm sure that there will be many good opportunities for us. So, thank you very much. If there's time, I'm open for your question.
Thank you. Any questions from the audience? Thank you. Oh. Can I ask the dividend yields of both of the of Heidelberg and Ringmetall?
Heidelberg is about 4% now at these prices, and Ringmetall a bit lower, around 3%.
And of Ringmetall, it struck me as a very typical value play.
It is, yeah.
Right? With such a high market share. But those ring clamps seem to be cheap, as you mentioned, but also perhaps cheap to copy. Does the company have any patents or?
There are no patents, but they built the machinery itself to produce these clamping rings. And it's really a matter of safety. So the big clients don't buy their clamping rings at a Chinese competitor, for example, or the chemical companies that go into China buy it there at Ringmetall.
So the big chemical companies, they perhaps exclusively sell to Ringmetall rather than, that may be me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Mm. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gil.
Thank you.